Hi, my name is Joseph Ally. Welcome to my channel. And today I want to talk about how to visualize or imagine like a master. So I want to take you through the four-step process that I go through every single time to guarantee that I'm doing this the exact way that should be done. I've used this method countless times, a number of times, thousands of times, with extreme effectiveness. And this is one of the most asked questions that I get is, am I doing this right? So first of all, if you have not done so already, absolutely hit that like button. It does something to the YouTube algorithm, which will allow this to be seen by people who may not normally be able to see this. And that's been working, so keep it up. And subscribe, hit the bell icon, stay tuned for more laser-targeted, systematic ways to deliberately manifest in a systematic, predictable way. And also, stay tuned towards the end or in the middle of this somewhere. I'm going to talk about a special announcement that I have as far as something that's going to take place tomorrow. And so definitely stay tuned. It's something that's going to be awesome and free and amazing, and it's going to have cool things. So I know that tells you a lot, but stay tuned for that. So let's just jump right into it then. Manifesting is something that is done with and through the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind is essentially connected to that infinite, all-powerful being, which I choose to call God, which then, when accepted by the subconscious mind, when handed off into the awareness, it is then refracted out in a miraculous way that we could never have consciously devised. So the idea then is to impress the subconscious mind. That's the solution. So how do we do that properly? What's the most effective way? So mainstream has a lot of different ideas how to do this. Some just say feel good. Some say visualize on a movie. I say, and Neville Goddard says, that there's a very much more direct, specific, exact way. And that's what we're focused on in this channel. So we outline the end result because that's what we want to manifest on the world. And just a little backstory on how this works. The thing that we are aware of, right? So there is the self of man, which is God, and then there's the manifested self, which is the ego, the Joseph Ally, the your first and last name. And so, but beyond that, when we remove this or shut off this egoic self, when we shut off the senses, when we shut off this external world, then we're left with just that which is aware of being Joseph Ally, but no longer aware of Joseph Ally in this current state. Now, whatever we give to that formless imagination, that creation aspect of the world, which is inside of us, which is inside of you and me and everyone around the world, has the self same exact power because we're all the same being, this awareness that's aware of our experience. When we bring forth a scene into that awareness, it refracts it out, it carbon copies it exactly the way that we've experienced it. It's replicated outward in our world, in our experience, so that we experience it in the exact way that we've imagined it. So I guess if you wanted to sum that up, it's like a photocopier. It's like whatever we imagine, the exact nature of that will be pushed out. It will be refracted out. It's like, as I've mentioned before, it's like one of those prisms that refracts light, except awareness is refracting out not just light, but people, places, things, experiences, feelings, moods, weather, mountains, landscapes, the whole thing, all experiences, all businesses, every single thing, all relationships. That's the refracting power because all things exist within awareness. And so it has all power. Even the power of creation comes from awareness. And since we are awareness, that's our true self, not the egoic self, not this flesh suit. In the Bible, it says, and he was dressed in a robe that was dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. So what it's basically saying is the awareness or God became us, and so that we have full reign to manifest since we are that as our essential being. So going back to the topic at hand, if we bring forth a proper imaginal act, if we can know exactly how to impress the subconscious mind in an exacting way, in a way that's predictable and systemized, then we can do it every time and know exactly what to do. If we can get a system, then we can repeat that system. That's what systems are for. That's what my obsession is creating systems. And so take, for example, getting a job. Take for example, being with a specific person, being married, or Something of the like. So the idea is first we want to know what we really want, right? So as a matter of fact, we'll go with the job because I was just talking with someone before and I said, what do you want? What do you want to do? What's your ideal job position? Because she is leaving her job and she wants to know what she wants to do. So she said, I want to be a director of, or something like that, some director of some company. But she said, I don't want to be any director. I want to be like a higher up director and some, whatever the title was. And she said that, but then she started listing out the traits, right? So before this, she had told me what she was imagining. She was imagining she was a director at this company, whatever. So, but she started listing out the traits of this job position that she seeks. And I said, well, tell me what you actually want. What do you actually want? She says, well, I want to be able to travel. I want to be important. I want to be able to have an impact on the business. I want to be international. I want to communicate with clients and I want to have an impact on the product itself from start to finish. And I said, that is what you want to base your scene off of. You see, putting a name on it by saying a director, you don't know, she didn't know which company to be the director of. The thing is you can be a director, but you could be packing shoelaces and be the director of packing shoelaces. So it's not necessarily the title that she, oh, and she wanted money, a lot of money too. So it's not the name that she was wanting. She was trying to, really what she was doing was thinking of a middle to get her those traits. Now this is a very, very important aspect that needs to be addressed and needs to be said again to understand this. So a lot of times we say, okay, we're in a lot of trouble financially or something. And so we'll say, okay, I want to be the lead engineer at, I don't know, Joseph Allies company or something like that. The problem is that is a middle. What they really want, what she really wanted, my client, was to be free, was to travel, was to have an impact, was to be important, to feel like what she was doing was mattering, that it was having an effect on the way that she felt positively so she could feel fulfilled in her life. And so once this was brought up, it was like, okay, that makes perfect sense. So we take that and we write those traits down. This is so crucial. This should not, cannot, do not overlook this, writing it down first. Now, is it essential to write it down to manifest? No, because the end result comes from the imaginal act. But many times people flounder, and I did this even now. If I'm lazy and don't feel like writing something down, I will not have an accurate or a clear mindset when I'm going into the scene. So what I want to do right now is say, let's take you through this process. If you want to, follow along. If not, watch it again later and follow through. But write down those traits of the exact things that you wish to experience. What do you really want? What is the feeling that you want? What is the objective that you wish to experience? What is the traits of the thing that you think you want? So take what you think. If you can't think of this, think of, okay, so you've given something a title. You want to be a director. Why? Ask yourself why. And the thoughts that come up, those are what you're writing down. Why? Because it's sometimes, and I've experienced this myself, sometimes I've wanted to manifest a specific thing only to find out that specific thing sucked. It was terrible. I wanted to get out and run. This has happened time and time again. But when, even this, from what I'm doing now, from even being on YouTube in the first place, which is a manifestation, that's why this is all blowing up so fast. It's a manifestation. I did not force this. I did not say I want to be a YouTuber. That's actually the opposite of what I said. So we list the traits, right? My traits myself was I wanted to impact people. I wanted to be free. I wanted to make money. And I wanted to be happy and grateful and feel fulfilled. It's very similar to what she wanted. So you write these traits down. This is what I wrote down. And then from there, you say, what can be a scene which would imply that this were true? What's the scene? What are you going to do? What do you want? What would you be doing if this was already true? Now, keep in mind, I said before, it's like a photocopier. Whatever you present in your imagination will be carbon copied outward, which means if you manifest or imagine something superior, big, awesome, great, and you only give the end result, it will be carbon copied out. But there's a gap of time between the time we imagine and the time this happens. What about all the obstacles in the middle? What about the system, the plan, the directions, the business plan, how I'm gonna do this, who I'm gonna contact? That is why we manifest, because the manifestation, by taking the screenshot or the photocopy of the end result and it's projected outward, that means that stuff in the middle must be filled in on the way there. So the infinite intelligence of God, when we give it to awareness, He projects it outward, but everything in the middle is filled out or filled in a perfect manner. So we say, what would be happening if this were true? So in her case, what we came up with was being in China, which is a company that she would like to do business with, wherever she was doing business with. She had been there before. And talking on the phone and explaining how happy she was about her current state of affairs. Like, I love my job. I love being able to travel. I love making a lot of money and I love being free. I love having an impact. And then having the person that she was talking to on this phone reiterating it back to her saying, you sound happy with this job, making a lot of money, such and so forth. Now with me, in my case, what I did was I was on my laptop, and I know I've shared this before, but I was on vacation somewhere, sitting on like some porch, overlooking some foreign something. I was on vacation and I had my laptop and I closed it and I looked to the person to the right of me and said, I'm so grateful that it's Tuesday and I'm wrapped up with work. And so all these different things are applied there. The tangible result of something that would imply that you already have it. So take that moment, write down the different traits, create a scene. Take that moment now, create a scene from the traits if you're following along. If not, come back to this, do this, it's so important. This will break everything wide open for you, right? Create a scene, right? Create a scene for her in China on the phone with someone explaining her gratitude for her current position. For me, it was on vacation, closing the laptop, saying, I'm so grateful that I'm wrapped up with work already, right? All this implied that I was free, that I had money, that I was able to do whatever I wanted, that I was grateful, and her the same deal. And so from this point forward, which is the meat of this video, once you've done that, this is the time to imagine. So imagining itself should be done with a fresh slate, with a clean slate, with flushing out this reality. The idea is we want to experience there and then now. I want to experience being on the laptop, closing it, talking to the person next to me, here and now. She wants to be in China, talking on the phone with someone, expressing her gratitude for her new job, here and now. And that means we don't want to blend in this current reality with that imaginal reality. We want a clean slate. We want to impress this properly. We want to get an actual screenshot of what it would be like if you were there. So some of the important steps to doing this is that you must be in first person point of view. Why? Because the knower, awareness, the God inside of you is the one that manifests, and it's coming through your personal experience. So in order to carbon copy you receiving the thing that you wish to experience, you must be doing it in the tense, in the point of view of yourself in first person point of view from the person who's receiving the manifestation. So that's key number one. You wanna be in your own eyes. You wanna be, from your own self, right? You don't wanna be seeing yourself on a movie. That's one of the differences between success and failure. Because if not, then there's a chance, like a 50% chance, that you will get it or another person will get it and you'll perceive someone else getting it. So why do I say it's a 50% chance and not a 0% chance? Because depending on the way that you use your faculties, there's a slight chance that you'll still get it, but there's a half chance that you won't get it. So, but rather with the first person point of view, and like I said, with my channel, all I talk about is the precise exact way. Now, just to keep in mind, this has gotten me out of poverty. This has gotten me out of addiction. This has gotten me out of life or death situations, manifesting. I was in despair, in trouble, curtains were closing. I had given up hope. Manifesting got me from there to here, which is free, self-employed, free from the 9-to-5, loving friends, fulfilled life, freedom from addiction, all this stuff. So The way that I did this is from testing all these things. So first person point of view is one of the most essential, crucial fundamentals of manifesting. So I say that all just to say we want to be specific, we want to be precise. Other things work sometimes, this will work every time. Mainstream says movies, but the success, and I'm sure you've experienced this, is hit or miss. This is accurate, systematic, deliberate, laser targeted every time. So, okay, enough ranting about that. So once we've said, okay, first person point of view, and we know the end, right? Those are the two basic fundamentals. So we wanna give us a clean slate. So what we wanna do is close our eyes. What that will do automatically, just as you're falling asleep, like the same way, the world kind of gets shut out. You're not really paying attention to your thinking for some reason. I mean, sorry, to your hearing, what you hear externally when you have your eyes closed for some reason, right? Your eyes closed is a way to put you into a state. It's a physiological thing. When you close your eyes, you have a better opportunity and you automatically, your mind automatically begins to shut out this external world, which is exactly what we want to do because we want to remove the concept of ourself, Joseph Ally's self, and then remove the concept of this world. Flush it out. Remove the remnants completely, meaning we're not thinking from this person anymore. We're not thinking about yesterday. We're not thinking about what we have to do tomorrow. We're not thinking, oh my God, I don't want to be imagining right now. I need to wake up early. We want to be thinking nothing from this being. And the way to do that, as I said, is closing your eyes, laying down if you need to. That's the way that I do it often. Or I sit down in a comfortable place, something that's comfortable. And if I'm sitting, it actually doesn't matter from this point, but sitting or laying down, whatever you choose, just do it in a way that you're not going to fall asleep yet. So once we've closed our eyes, the idea then is to breathe. Breathe from your gut. That's the most effective way. Breathing from your diaphragm actually increases your emotional experience and because it increases oxygen and it actually helps with your body all around. But in the tense, I only care about manifesting. That's all I care about for the most part. So when you breathe through your gut, you can get a better sensation of feeling, which makes it more real. Instead of breathing in from your chest, it's more of a stressful thing. It's not what, you think of what a baby does. A baby's breathing from their gut, from their stomach, right? Men and women, as they get older, dealing with stress, they breathe in, it's a stress response, right? So breathing in through your gut. You breathe in through your gut. Now, what we're doing that is we relax almost instantly. When you breathe in through your gut and take huge breaths, like I said, there's more oxygen, so you get relaxed much, much quicker. And that's just a trick for anxiety altogether, basically. If you feel stressed out or anxious, instead of taking big breaths through your chest, take big breaths through your gut. You can practice this. Look it up. It's diaphragmic breathing. So, okay, we're breathing in through our gut now. After that, we want to clear out the thoughts, right? So we focus on our breathing, but at the same time, we start counting backwards. Focusing on our breathing in and of itself should center us a bit and allow our mind to not be thinking about other things. We can only be aware of one thing at a time. That's why if we focus on the breathing, we're not thinking about where we are here and now. We're not thinking about tomorrow or yesterday or any of that stuff. Our eyes closed, breathing deeply through our gut, focusing on our breathing, and then starting to count backwards from 300. If we can do this, and I'm not saying to hit zero, that's actually not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is to just start to count backwards. I choose an outrageously high number because then we're not worried or anxious to hit zero. We don't want to run out of time. So we choose 300. We ain't going to get down from 300. Just is not going to happen. Now, whether it takes 10 seconds, 30 seconds, a minute, 2 minutes, doesn't matter. Eventually, if we can focus on the number, focus on our breathing, have our eyes closed and be breathing semi-deeply, we should be able to center ourselves. Now, we may not be able to completely forget the exterior world. We may not be able to completely stop yesterday and tomorrow's thoughts or now's thoughts, but we want to do this to the most effective point possible. Right now, like again, I'm not gonna hammer this too much more, but what we talk about here is the precise, accurate, best case scenario, the 5% of techniques out there that get 95% of the results every time. So counting backward now, we're starting to count, focus on our breathing. That in and of itself are two things to focus on. It has nothing to do with anything of this outside world, so we should be centered within a few minutes, a few seconds, 10 seconds, 30 seconds. Do not rush this. If you rush this, you will be left with remnants of this external world and what you have to do yesterday and today, and the whole thing will be ineffective to a large degree. Can you still manifest with all these things going on? Absolutely. But again, like I said, the most effective thing. So you get centered, you get prepared, you get relaxed. Actually, I hate that word centered. You get relaxed, you get focused on yourself. You're not thinking about anything else. Now you begin to bring the scene into your imagination. Now, how do I do this? I will start by, here's a trick. This is a trick that I have figured out a little while ago. I haven't shared it with you guys yet. So here you go. The trick is, so what I used to say, and this still works very well, but I got kind of immune to it, is imagine your hands in front of your face. Why? Why are you doing that? Because we should be looking from our own eyes, and looking at our hands will get us into first person point of view. Now, I shouldn't be seeing myself and my hands. I should only be seeing my hands all the way up to about here. Why? Because I'm in first person point of view. I'm looking from the direction of my own eyes in the scene, not as if it's a movie. There's a huge critical difference there. So we're looking now at our hands. This is the way that I used to do it, and I still sometimes do this. And then what I'll do is I'll look down at my feet, right? I'll look at my chest, my shorts, my shoes. And so that will bring you into first person point of view, and then you can scan yourself up and down. Now, at this point, your mind may start wandering a little bit again. This is the point where we calibrate. We calibrate. That's the first step of imaginal act, is calibrating. That's what this is called. Looking at our hands, looking at our feet, looking at our hands. If mind wanders, bring it back. Recalibrate. Hands, feet, up and down, up and down. We're looking at ourselves, but from our own vantage point of our own eyes, the focal point of our own eyes. So we're calibrating here. If you can do this successfully, brilliant. But here's the trick. Here's the shortcut way. Here's the way that I added another overarching layer on top of this. It's very interesting. I can't do it on camera, but tying your shoe from first person point of view. Now you can start out like this, looking at your hands and feet, but when you have the direction or the objective of tying your shoe, then it does something to the mind, because now you're no longer just focused on being on first person point of view. You're actually getting lost within this. Now you have an overarching goal, which makes it easier to automatically go into first person point of view. So I will tie my shoe. I'll tie my shoe. Now, I want to make something very clear here. The visuals in imagining oftentimes are unclear. They're either blurry or dark, but if you know it, if you know that you're doing it, then that is actually effective enough to a degree. Now we'll talk a little bit more about the most effective way, but you don't need to worry if you can't actually see something with your imagination. But in the best case scenario, you can, and you can work yourself up, train your imagination to be able to do this. But in effect, the shadowy figures, the knowingness of doing this is what is effective. And a way to test yourself with this is to do this right now. Close your eyes. Imagine that you're holding an apple in your left hand. Maybe this is left for you guys. I don't know how this works. But and then it has the letter J on it for Joseph. So you look at it. It's a red apple. It's juicy. And you have it there, and it says a J on it for Joseph. So now open your eyes. Open your eyes. Do you remember what you've just imagined? Yes, you saw an apple with a J on it. Can you remember? Yes, then you've done it properly. If you can remember holding the apple in your hand with a J on it, then you've done it properly. And that's everyone that I've ever met can do this. So, okay, we're first person point of view. We're tying our shoe. What do we do after we calibrate? So after we calibrate, that's when we start to materialize. That's when we materialize the setting. So at that point, now remember, if the mind wanders all along this whole time, it's okay if the mind wanders a little bit. It's okay if some contrary thoughts come in, some weird thoughts, some whatever thoughts. But the point is to keep bringing our mind back. We keep calibrating this whole time. Eventually, we'll get to a point where we don't need to calibrate, and that'll be later in this process. But we calibrate. we start to populate the setting, right? So we've outlined the scene. For me, I was on the deck. I was staring out over wherever the heck I was staring, some nature or something or another. And person was next to me. I had the laptop on my lap. I closed it and I said whatever I said. I'm so grateful that whatever. So, but at this point forth, we're just trying to get the scene into place. So what's the scene? The scene is the deck, the trees, and the laptop on me, myself, and the person next to me. That's what's my scene is. That's the setting, right? So at this point forth, now this takes a little while, right? It may take a little while depending on how good you are at this, but to make sure that you add this setting into place without it all flying all over the place or spinning around or just your mind going somewhere else, this is the point. We must calibrate this whole time. We must allow this stuff to materialize while we are calibrated. So we bring this scene forth, right? We bring this scene forth. If the mind wanders, we bring it back. Mind wanders, bring it back. All along this whole process, if the mind wanders, we just bring it back gently. Don't be hard on yourself. At this point, we're not trying to impress right now. We want to wait to impress when we're calibrated. So the materialization of the setting is there. If you can get this to stay, that's great. After that, that's when you want to start animating it. You want to animate it. So in this case, I'll close the laptop, and I'm looping this whole time. So one thing that I want to, and I should have mentioned this before, but the types of scenes that we want to create are 3 to 5 seconds long. And the reason for this is because we want to be able to loop them with a seamless loop. Now, the key here is an example is shaking someone's hand is a seamless loop. You can keep repeating it over and over. Kissing someone is a seamless loop. You can do it over and over. Saying congratulations, hearing congratulations, you can do that over and over. And congratulations, 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 congratulations. So we want to try to create a seamless loop. Now, if we can't do a seamless loop, it's all good. I do this all the time. For instance, maybe like walking into a room. We walk into a room. We're not going to walk out of a room, but we walk into the room. We see, or we walk on stage and we see the million people applauding. We can walk on stage. And then once we're there, cut it, bring it back, walk on stage, bring it there. Now, so, okay. So we have the scene materialized, the setting materialized in front of us. Now we're beginning to animate it. Whatever it is, we're animating it. Shaking hands, me closing the laptop, closing the laptop, closing the laptop. She's on the phone, happy, 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 nodding, whatever. Now we want to add the sensory vividness, right? So we want to, again, take the carbon copy of what we would feel like if we were actually there. So in this case, now I am adding closing the laptop, saying I'm so grateful that it's Tuesday and I'm already done with my work or whatever it was that I said. And for her, I love this job. I love this job. I love that I have all the things that I've ever wanted in a job. And we keep doing this. Now we loop it. We loop it. The point of looping it, now at this point, again, we're not going for the impression yet. This is not when we're going for the impression. So until this point, if people are saying funny things, if bad things are happening, if your mind keeps wandering, if an alien floats in, if you suddenly go to third person and come back, it's all good, man. It's totally cool. From this point forth, though, what we want to do is keep looping it over and over until it finally becomes a seamless loop of animating effort in your subconscious mind, in your imagination. So it goes calibrate, materialize, animate, and then add sensation. So we do that. Calibrate, materialize, and then whatever the heck I just said. So we do this over and over and over and over and over again. And eventually what happens is it becomes natural. It becomes natural. So we want to keep doing it until it becomes natural, until it feels, and we want to add sensation, add speech, whatever. If we can keep doing this over and over, eventually the actual side effect will be emotion. You don't have to force emotion into these scenes. You have to just play the scene over and over. If you're in it first person, if you really are experiencing this in your imagination, eventually the side effect will be emotion, just like reality. I don't know what's going to happen when I walk out my front door, but when it happens, the side effect of it is emotion. If someone texts me in 5 minutes and says to me, Joseph, I love you. I want you to be my boyfriend, right? I'm not expecting that. But if that's what was said, then the emotions will follow. So just in that same likeness as we're replicating it with the true intent or emulation of reality, we play the scene over and over, and a side effect, a natural side effect of the scene that we're now a part of, that we're looping, we should develop a side effect of emotion. If we do not experience feelings as a result of being in this scene, then add them yourself manually. But remember, it doesn't always mean an intense, extreme emotional response. If I'm in China and I'm on the phone and I'm saying, I'm so grateful that I'm here, it doesn't mean I'm in tears. I didn't just get the job yesterday, otherwise how could I be in China already? So sometimes the shock wears off. We want to make an actual lifelike carbon copy representation of the experience that would unfold if we were actually there. And if we do this enough, looping that short condensed scene over and over and over, then we will eventually, a lot of times, there's this side effect feeling of satisfaction that unfolds within you. For me, it unfolds right here, near underneath the chest. It's a satisfactory feeling. If we can do this and achieve that satisfactory feeling, for me, I know it's done. Now, do I always achieve that feeling? No. If you fall asleep while imagining this, it's done. Even if you just let go and go about your day after you've achieved it, a realistic representation of the experience you would experience, it's done. And so, if you can do that on the first day, you will plant the seed. Now, sometimes your manifestation will be instant. It depends upon the world without, the experience or the current state of affairs that whatever it is that you want is in. It could be instant. Everything could fall into place immediately. It always comes in a natural way, though. So from what I've experienced, 99% of the times, things come in a natural way, which means someone's going to reach out about the job. Or in my case, someone reached out to me and said, can I put one of your blog posts on my YouTube channel? I said, sure, go ahead, but I'm not making a channel. She said, okay, no problem. But when she recorded the video, she said, look out for Joseph's upcoming YouTube channel. So she put me on the spot. It led me to one thing to the next, then coaching. I said, nah, I'm not doing it, bruh. Then hundreds of people reached out to me until I felt obliged to do it. And one thing led to another, I was free. So similar things, natural things, but everyone in the world will be moved to play their part to get you what you want. But it must come in a natural way. It could take instant. In my case, it was within days where she had reached out to me, or the same day. But then in 2 weeks, things were really rolling and the rest is history. Now I'm here. This thing is exploding, right? The reason this is exploding so fast, the channel's growing so fast, is I really truly attribute to the reason that this is all a manifestation. I did not specify a YouTube channel. I did not specify coaching. I did not specify any of this stuff. I just allowed for the general specific traits and then the rest filled in the blanks in a way that hit all of my different skills perfectly to the point where I have full fulfillment. I love teaching this stuff. I love seeing the results. I love getting testimonies, thousands. And when I say thousands and thousands, I mean it literally. I've manifested more things than I could ever fathom. Now, given we're always manifesting, but I mean deliberate. See, I keep track of mine, which is what I would highly recommend for you. Log and keep track. Eventually, you'll realize that you'll be able to write stuff down and it'll manifest. So for me, I write things down 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 things a day. And the tense, always keep the tense of I am, I have. Not I will, not I did, always I am. And so 20, 30, 40 things a day, span years, 9 years. I didn't do it that whole time with the writing down, but do the math, thousands of things, tens of thousands of things. And you could be there too. If you do this properly, the direct way, cut out the mainstream, go focus for this laser targeted manifesting of testing it yourself, proving what works, proving what doesn't work. You'll be a master, you'll be an expert. Use this simple formula, right? Use the simple formula, you will get whatever you want. The one more thing that I mentioned earlier is how to get your imagination to get stronger, how to be able to perceive actually to the extent to which we're really there. So one of the most common questions that I get is it okay if I'm just seeing nothing or shadowy figures, but I know that it's happening? And I gave you the example of if you held an apple in your hand with the letter J on it, and you open your eyes, can you remember what you've just imagined? The answer is yes. So that's perfect, that's fine. But if you can begin to push your imagination to make it stronger, to be able to see more vivid, then you will have a much more effective imaginal act, to the extent to which you will manifest more in a more powerful way, in a more accurate way, in a way in which you will be certain 100% of the time that you have imagined it correctly. And so the way to do this is to just push your imagination. So imagination should be something practiced and tested and continuously strengthened to the point where you make it brighter and more vivid. Now, one of the times, or what I will actually do is I will think of a scene, whether it's something that I already know or something that I have imagined before. But now, while I'm doing this, I'm not going for accuracy. I'm not going for something specific generally. Sometimes I do. So if I want something specific, perhaps I'll test it out on this. But the risk here is that we're putting in a lot of effort. But what happens is we can actually go into our imagination and try to bring something there, something maybe familiar, something that you're not wondering what details to add, and you just push it. What do I mean by push it? Like, use effort, use strength, continuously try to hold it there and add more detail. If you can do this, you keep doing this, you don't let up. If you keep trying to will or force or add more detail or fixate on something, eventually what will happen is you will break through. You'll break through and you will eventually be able to see the thing that you're imagining. What do I mean by see? I mean no more dark shadowy figures. No more just knowing that it's there. You will literally be able to hold the scene in place. Now, I've talked to thousands of people. I've had one person, and I've talked to a lot of people who are really pretty good at manifesting. There are not many people who can do this, right? But why? Why don't they do this? And I figured out why. See, for me, when I got into manifesting, I pushed really, really hard. I knew that not in the beginning, but later towards the end, when I got to Neville Goddard, I realized that my imagination was God, and that if that was true, then if I strengthened my imagination, then in theory, this was my idea anyway, then I would be able to have more power. So that's what I did. With the obsessive mind that I have, with the brute force, the willpower that I have, I sat there and I imagined to the point where eventually one day I was actually in a room in my imagination. Like literally there. So what does that mean? That means I could see the walls. That means I could see the floor. That means I can see the doorway, the windows. I still remember this exact place. It was a little room. And when I would move my head, even in real life, the room would stay fixed. So I would actually be able to look around in this place. It wouldn't go with me when I moved, right? Like you would think would happen with imagining. But just as a room like this, when I look around, I see the window, I see my desk, I see the camera, I see the lights, I see the door, I see the light, I see the painting. But generally when we imagine, when we close our eyes, if we turn our head, we're still seeing the same thing the whole time. So say I was imagining a door right here. If I turn my head, I would still see the door right here, right? In the imagination, because imagination will be fixed. But once you break through to this point, once you push your effort, if the door is here, I will be able to turn my head and the door will stay here and I'll be looking at something completely different. Now, the imagination is powerful. It's an emanation of God inside of us. And so creation occurs instantly. So like when I turn my head, I didn't need to realize what was there. It was automatically already there. It was created once I entered into this scene. So push your imagination. There's little things you can do, like imagining that you're in one place, then a next, then in the next. But the idea is to force it, to use your force, to use your willpower. And this is extreme effort, which is why I don't suggest doing this when you're imagining for whatever you want, because we're supposed to negate effort. It's supposed to be effortless. But eventually, if you can break through, then it will be effortless. And then you can, so what you eventually will be able to do is bring the scene that you want into your imagination and push through. It still takes me effort. I don't always hit this point because sometimes I'm too tired. Sometimes I don't have that much time. It takes effort and time. But experiment, push through, be another person, and I want your results actually from doing this and testing this. Another time that's ideal for this is literally beyond exhaustion. When I'm beyond exhaustion, sometimes I'll close my eyes and I'll already almost be dreaming while awake. And so that happens often. If I'm really, really tired, I can do that. I'll close my eyes and I'm already almost dreaming. That's like one of the most perfect times to easily enter into this state. So absolutely do that. Try it out, push it, test different things, and I want your results. Now, when I do this, they always come. Everything comes, no question, 100% of the time. There's still a time delay depending on the amount of things that have to move, but it will happen. So I wanna talk to you real quick about the announcement that I brought up in the before. So tomorrow I'm going to be having a live workshop. So the workshops that I do that have paid admittance, this is completely free. It's gonna have all the materials. It's gonna be the exact same format. And the topic is going to be the fundamentals of manifesting, how to manifest. And it's gonna be extremely intricate. I want to give this to you as a gift so that you can participate in the workshops just like the other people who have found tremendous results in this. So absolutely stay tuned. What I'm gonna do is post the details below. And so check that out, don't miss it. Cancel all your plans, no matter what it is. I don't care if it's a marriage. I don't care if you have to go to court. Just bail out. Check out this workshop because it's gonna change your life. So anyway, thank you so much for watching this. Make sure you check that out, like that. Subscribe if you wanna see more videos like this because I go into the non-mainstream, the things that they don't tell you about how to systematically, deliberately manifest the life that you want in a laser-targeted, precise, absolutely certain way that you can depend on, a dependable way. And so hit the subscribe button, bell icon, stay tuned for more. I post very frequently. Thank you so much for watching.